My dearest female friend and I recently celebrated milestone birthdays. I agonized for weeks over what to give as a gift to this woman who's been such a blessing in my life for so many years. I even Googled the perfect gift for the friend you adore and appreciate for always being there through thick and thin and is an all-around fabulous human being. Well, the results were not what I had hoped for. So I prayed, which was arguably the first thing I should have done, but that is a topic for another class. When I prayed, the Lord put a word on my heart. It was joy. If you know me, you know there's always a backstory, but I promise that this one will be uncharacteristically short. My dearest friend's name is Alicia, and by all intents and purposes, Alicia has a wonderful life. She loves the Lord. She has a thriving dental practice, a wonderful, loving husband, and she's in great health, very physically fit. As a matter of fact, at her 25th wedding anniversary, Alicia wore the same wedding dress that she was married in. Now, by comparison, I don't think I even fit in the same shoe size that I wore 25 years ago. As wonderful as her life is on all these many, many levels, like some of us, she has deep pain from her past. Like most of us, she's got angst in her everyday life. Alicia has a choice every single day. She can choose the chaos of the moment, or she can choose joy. Biblical joy is not conditional. It doesn't change with time nor circumstance. Here's what my Bible commentary says about biblical joy. Jesus keeps God's commands and abides in his love. If we keep Jesus's commands, we will abide in his love. This will give us his joy and in its fullness. Keeping God's commandments is not about naive obedience to a narcissistic ruler and judge. All of God's commands are meant to keep us safe, free from sin and the consequences of sinful choices. God's commandments are his evidence of love for us. As a parent, I demonstrate my love for my children by making rules to keep them safe. I've had the advantage of many more years of experience, and my perspective is deeper than theirs. For instance, if I play with knives, there's a very good chance that I'll hurt myself, even after all my years of experience of using knives. For this reason, I instruct my children not to play with knives. Does this make me an unloving judge who doesn't want my children to experience life to the fullest? Am I preventing them from using their free will to choose how to entertain themselves? Certainly not. And while this is a very simplistic example, I think you understand the point that I'm making. It's out of love that I protect my children. And it's out of an immensely greater love that God does the same for us through his commandments. He demonstrates his love in an even deeper way by offering Jesus as the ultimate sacrifice for our sins. He knew from the beginning that our sinful natures would cause us to be drawn to the very things that would do us the most harm. He knew that we would struggle to keep his commandments. But of course, he had a plan to help us and guide us through this often challenging life. Jesus paid the price for our sin, and the Holy Spirit lives in those who put their faith in Christ so that we might have a guide. All of this to say that when we keep God's commandments, we can experience his joy because we are not under the hindrance of sin. In 1 Chronicles 16:26 through 27, the author emphasizes the splendor, majesty, strength, and joy before God in his place. Here we see that joy is also associated with strength. For the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his dwelling place. The connection between biblical joy and strength is also explained in part in Psalm 30:4-5, where David sings to the Lord, "Sing praises to the Lord, O you his saints, and give thanks in his holy name. For his anger is for but a moment, but his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes with the morning. David is associating God's anger with punishment. And while this could be debated as a consequence of David's sin, the point to focus on is that in praising God and showing gratitude to him for what he has done and what he will do, we will find true joy. God's joy fills us with hope, peace, security, and adoration. These cannot be changed by circumstance. God is eternal, and his joy does not change. His joy can see us through the worst of times and rejoices with us in the best of times. Let's look at Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Authentic joy is found in God's presence. Psalm 16:11 says, "You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand." Joy is possible in every season when we follow God's truth. Psalm 19:8 says, "The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes." Joy is found in the fruit of the Spirit, as described in Galatians 5:22 through 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. The fruit is the result of allowing the Holy Spirit to work in our lives. The Holy Spirit reveals God's presence to us and draws us closer to God. It's here that we experience biblical joy. During a sermon series on the gifts of the Spirit, Pastor Kevin explained that with any gift we receive, we must actively accept and open it to use the gift. When I receive a nicely wrapped package, I'm not just going to put it on the counter and admire it without even opening it. Now, I might take a picture or two and try and imitate it the next time I have to wrap a gift. But certainly, I know that the real treasure is what's inside the box. The fruit of the Spirit is not the same as the gifts of the Spirit. But in the same way, we must receive our spiritual gifts by opening and using them. The same is true for the fruit of the Spirit. It's available to us, but we still must choose joy. We all have a choice. In good times and challenging times, in sorrow and grief, in loss and disappointment, we can still choose joy. In the same way we choose to be patient and kind, we can choose joy over frustration and angst. Choosing joy is also a witness to others. I'm not talking about a phony Pollyanna persona that everything's okay all the time. But when we exemplify the peace that comes from biblical joy, it speaks loudly to the world around us, particularly those who don't yet know Jesus. Back to Alicia. When we met to celebrate our birthdays, I presented her with a journal that had prompts to help her choose joy every day. I also gave her a wooden sign that my son Brandon had made in shop class that said, "Choose joy." Well, I wasn't sure if she'd be excited about the gift, at least as excited as I was. But when I gave it to her with tears in her eyes, she said, "I can't believe this. We never even talked about it." Alicia had been struggling with finding joy. I'm so glad that I listened to what God put on my heart to reinforce this idea of choosing joy for my sweet, dear friend. Alicia isn't the only one who needs to be reminded to choose joy. It's a great lesson for me, too. I often let my circumstances dictate my mood, my responses, and my overall outlook. Over time, if we aren't choosing joy in the midst of our circumstances, we'll begin to experience anxiety, anger, irritability, restlessness. We'll feel overwhelmed, unmotivated, unfocused, and potentially make bad decisions. According to WebMD, people who exhibit psychological and emotional signs of stress often have trouble sleeping or sleep too much. We experience racing thoughts, constant worry, and memory issues. I know it's hard to choose joy, especially when everything around us seems to be falling apart. But we read in James 1, 2 through 4, that we should consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work, so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Consider it pure joy. Are you kidding me? One might think that James had never encountered any trials, but that wasn't the case. Actually, James is recalling Jesus' statement in John 16:33, where he says, I have told you these things, so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Trouble here is translated from the Greek word for persecution, affliction, distress, and tribulation. And in James, the word for trials is the Greek word which means the experience of evil, discipline, provocation, by implication, or adversity. In other words, it's something that occurs that's not necessarily because of a bad choice that we've made, but rather caused by a situation that's out of our control. Because we live in a sinful, fallen world, we will experience tribulation and trials. We grow more from suffering and disappointment than we do from successes if we allow God to work in and through us in the midst of the trial. Easier said than done, I know. But this is the outcome when we focus on the good that will come from the experience. God is often allowing the trial to refine us. I think James Bryant Smith, the author of The Good and Beautiful God, says it best. Here's what we can count on, he says. God promises that those who love and serve and are honest and faithful will know a kind of joy and peace that those who are evil never will. In Hebrews 13:5, Paul reminds us to be content with what we have, because God has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. If we embrace this promise, I believe there's peace in knowing that God is and always will be with us. When I hold tight to God's promises, I find that my anxiety is lessened and I can experience His joy. My circumstances may not have changed, but my perspective certainly has. Martin Lloyd-Jones says, joy, in other words, is the response and reaction of the soul to a knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. For those who put their faith in the Lord, we know our salvation is secure. We'll spend eternity in heaven. Life is but a blip, but in the thick of it, I know it feels much heavier. In Nehemiah 8, the Israelites had just returned to Jerusalem from exile. As the priests read to them from the law, they wept out of remorse for how far they'd strayed from God's commands. But Nehemiah, Ezra, and the priests instructed them to celebrate their return to Jerusalem and their repentance. God rejoiced in being reunited with His people, and they too were reminded that the joy of the Lord is your strength. Being obedient to God and in fellowship with Him is where we find biblical joy. Here we benefit from His strength to see us through any circumstance. Recently, I found this quote on the Compassion website. The difference between joy and happiness lives in the mind and the heart. Joy is in the heart, happiness is on the face. Joy is of the soul, happiness is of the moment. Joy transcends. Happiness reacts. Joy embraces peace and contentment, waiting to be discovered. Joy is a practice and a behavior. It's deliberate and intentional. Happiness comes and goes blithely along its way. Joy is an inner feeling. Happiness is an outward expression. Joy endures hardship and trials and connects with meaning and purpose. A person pursues happiness, but chooses joy. You see, happiness is situational. It isn't a choice. They go on to say, joy requires the utmost surrender, and like love, it is a choice to be made. Joy is not simply a feeling that happens. In its truest expression, joy transforms difficult times into blessings and turns heartache into gratitude. They conclude by saying, it's possible to experience joy in difficult times. It's possible to know joy or feel joy in spite of grief or uncertainty. Joy doesn't need a smile to exist. I don't know about you, but that's exactly what I needed to hear right now. Life is uncertain, but God is consistent. If I keep my focus on Him, I can experience His joy each and every day. I'm looking forward to sharing ideas with you during our discussion time. Next week, we'll talk about choosing peace in the midst of chaos.
Thanks for viewing the teaching online. Please join us for a time of discussion beginning at 6:30 p.m. To join, please visit our Wednesday Night at Shoreline online page on our website and click Join Discussion for this Wednesday night's class discussion time. We will be digging deeper into the truths that we have just been learning about together and spending some time in fellowship and in prayer. We'll see you then.